Did you know that the shape of your nose is not random at all? It's a survival tool fine-tuned over thousands of years. From the frozen Arctic to the steaming jungles of Africa, our noses become the frontline soldier of evolution, sculpted by the very air our ancestors breathed. Think of it this way. Every time you inhale, your nose is doing a job. In cold climates, it warms and moistens the freezing air so it doesn't damage your lungs. In dry deserts, it filters out dust and saves precious moisture. And in hot, humid jungles, it lets air flow in quickly and freely. It's like nature's air conditioner, but customized by geography. That's why a personal phenotype assessment report is such a valuable investment. Unlike vague racial labels, anthropological traits reveal a completely different story about who you are. From the climatic adaptations your ancestors evolved for, to inherited immunity against certain diseases, to potential health risks, and even lifespan predisposition. And it goes far beyond that. It's the safest and most affordable journey of self-discovery you can take, unlike anything else. The link and more details are in description. Now let's get back to today's topic. Our story begins long ago, when small bands of humans wandered out of Africa and spread across the globe. Imagine one group marching north into icy winds, their lungs burning with every frozen breath. Those who had slightly longer and narrower noses found it easier to survive and reproduce. And over countless generations, those traits became common. Now think of another group pushing into the tropics, where the air was heavy and wet. For them, wide noses were perfect. No need to waste energy warming or filtering air, just breathe in as much as possible. Anthropologists measure these differences with something called the nasal index, the ratio of the nose width to its length. Narrow noses have low index, wide noses have a high one. The very narrow type is called hyperlepterine, the medium type mesorine, and the wide type platyrrhine. At the extreme, some groups even have hyperplatyrrhine noses. Now let's start with the thinnest noses. The hyperlepterine nose, it has two variations, each adapted to some of the most extreme environments on Earth, one in the coldest regions and another in the hottest. In cold climates, hyperlepterine noses are usually straight and slightly turned upwards. This shape helps warm and humidify freezing air before it reaches the lungs. That's why many Scandinavians, Celts, Germanics, and Baltics have this form, as well as North American Inuit, who actually have the tiniest nasal openings of all human phenotypes. Meanwhile, in hot, dusty environments, the nose takes a different form, often longer and turned slightly downwards. This helps filter out dust, pollen, and microbes, while also humidifying dry air, especially useful in desert-dwelling Arabs. This version is common among Arabs, particularly those of the Arabian Peninsula, as well as other West Asian peoples such as Levantines, Mesopotamians, Iranics, and South Caucasians. In Africa, it appears among certain Berber groups, while a straighter, smaller version is found among Somalis. In Europe, similar forms can be seen in some Iberian and Italian groups, as well as the highland populations of the Dinaric Alps. Even in South Asia, Punjabis of North India and Pakistan often show this form. The more common narrow form, lepterine, spread across much of the Northern Hemisphere. Most Europeans, from Slavs to Sardinians, have lepterine noses. Much of Siberia, Northern China, and Turkic groups of Central Asia share this trait as well. In Africa, narrow lepterine noses are typical of Kushites, North Africans, and Ethiosemites. In the Americas, Many native group in temperate climates like the plains and forested tribes in the US and Canada to Patagonia or southern South America. And the people of the southern Andes also develop leptorhine noses. Then there are the mesorhine noses, neither narrow nor wide. These appear in transitional environments where balance mattered most. In South Asia, many people of the south, central, and eastern of the Indian subcontinent show mesorhiny. Across Southeast Asia, it is the most common type, from Burmese to Thai to Filipino groups. Mesorhine noses also dominate in Polynesia, among Hawaiians, Samoans, and Tongans. In the Americas, they are very common among tropical people such as the Mesoamerican groups and Amazonian tribes. But when our ancestors entered the lush green belts of Africa, the air was different again. Heavy with humidity, rich with heat. Here, wide platyrrhine noses become dominant. In West Africa, among Yoruba, Igbo, and Wolof people, platyrrhine noses is standard. It spreads southward into the Congo Basin, among Bantu groups, and even into Madagascar. In Asia, it appears among the Dayaks of Borneo, the Negritos from the Andaman to the Philippines, and some Indochinese mountain tribes. Across the Pacific, platyrrhine noses dominate among Papuans of New Guinea and the Melanesian people of Solomon Islands, among Aboriginal Australians too, especially in the north. And at the far extreme, we find
hyperplatyrrhine nose
among the pygmy people of Central Africa, like the Mbouti and Twa, and also Congolid people, can be so broad that they rival the width of the mouth. The same is true for the Khoisan groups of Southern Africa, such as the Komani. In Australia, Aboriginal groups of the Western Deserts and Arnhem Land show this extreme form. In Melanesia, New Caledonians are famous for it, and the now extinct Tasmanian Aboriginals also often had hyperleptyrrhine noses. If we step back and look at the map, a clear rule appears. Cold and dry zones favor narrow noses, humid tropics favor wide noses, and transitional zones fall somewhere in between. And what's fascinating, this pattern repeats across continents. Inuit in the Arctic and Bedouins in West Asia both develop hypernarrow noses, even though they never met. Yoruba farmers in Nigeria and Aboriginal Australians both develop wide noses, though they live in opposite sides of the world. Climate, not culture, shape these traits, a perfect example of convergent evolution. But the story of the nose isn't just science. For centuries, anthropologists tried to box people into rigid categories, as if human variation could be drawn in sharp lines. These divisions were used not only for study, but also for prejudice. Narrow noses were praised in some societies as a mark of beauty and superiority, while wider noses were unfairly stigmatized. What began as survival in a given climate was twisted into social hierarchy. Today, we understand that human variation is not a neat box, but a gradient and a spectrum. Every nose shape carries the history of ancestors who endured deserts, snowstorms, jungles, and plains. Our noses are proof that humans are adaptable, flexible, and deeply connected to the earth. They remind us, no matter how different we look, the same force shaped us all. Is the simple act of breathing. And speaking about human diversity, check out my other videos where I explain the diverse skin colors to diverse height range in human beings. And as always, stay curious, stay smart, and thank you very much for watching.